We provide what's considered non-medical care, so home health aides, certified nursing assistants, to help folks in their house. We do anything from 6 hours once a week to full 24/7 care. In our case, all of our aides are dementia trained, going through our own proprietary senior GEMS program, which was co-developed with our National Dementia Educator, keep us known. That's an important thing for you to understand if you're using home care services, because in Massachusetts, there are no licensing standards, there are no training standards, and there are no hiring standards, other than they pass a criminal background check.
Karen?
Good morning. It's nice to be here. I'm Carolyn Walsh. My company is called Senior Steps, and my tagline is navigating transitions in later life, which many of you are navigating. I'm a certified geriatric care manager, background in education and in nursing, so I have a strong clinical background. And somebody called me the other day. They said I was a life contractor. And then as I continued talking, they said, no, you're a fairy godmother. I like that term. But what I do is I work with families and their loved ones, and sometimes individuals themselves, and I help come up with a plan. So as caregivers, you're often dealing with a whole boatload of situations, not to mention working and raising your own families and trying to navigate life in general. And then you have a loved one who has some cognitive decline with Alzheimer's or other forms of dementia. And it's overwhelming. It's hard to know where to turn. And I'm that person that can step in and help you catch your breath and take a positive look at things and help you find the right resources for you. And part of that is that I help you navigate the medical world. So when Dr. Budson was talking about primary care physicians and really to what degree do they offer you assistance, I can get them on board and navigate things with the primary care. Oftentimes you're dealing also with a cardiologist, a urologist, a neurologist, any number of physicians, and you need to cover all those tracks. And I help you take care of that in a seamless way, getting all the doctors on board, providing that support.
So I definitely want to go through sort of a case scenario. I'm over here. I'm sorry, guys. I want to go through a case scenario just in terms of, we'll make up a story. But Elizabeth, why don't you tell us, give us your intro.
Good morning, everybody. I'm Elizabeth Caruso. I am an attorney at Baker, Braverman, and Barbadoro in Quincy. I'm an elder law attorney. So I specialize in estate planning, Medicaid planning, and estate administration. When I encounter a family who has just been given a diagnosis, it really depends on where they are in that diagnosis as to what we can do for them. We do everything from if they still have cognitive abilities to beginning steps of doing an estate plan that makes like things easier down the road. If they are further on and they're less cognitively able to participate in that estate planning process, we help families with the probate court process, getting permission to manage finances, make healthcare decisions through guardianship and conservatorships. And then once the family can no longer really handle things on their own, or home care is no longer an option, or a multitude of reasons why people end up in nursing homes, we do help them find a financially feasible way to fund that nursing home care, whether it be through qualifying for Medicaid or coming up with like a spending plan.
Karen,
what's your case scenario? Mom just got diagnosed. There's, let's say, 5 siblings. Do we do in-home care? Welcome to Italian families. Do we do in-home care? Do we do nursing, like, confusion with 5?
Utter chaos.
Yeah. How do you?
And real emotional eruption. I mean, this is a life-changing moment in people's lives, and it brings out all sorts of things. It brings up, you know, the sense of loss, this lack of control, old resentments, who had a better relationship with mom, all that type of stuff. And the first thing that I do is come in and meet with as many family members. I usually meet with one initially and then try to bring as many on board and meet and figure out who's the point person. And because everybody wants to say a lot of stuff, but that gets costly. So you have one person who can really navigate things and hold it, stay calm. And where do we go with home care? I mean, or nursing home care? There are wonderful, wonderful nursing homes out there with wonderful staff who are very hard on you. But my first option, and most families' first option, is in home care. And that's what we try to set up. And oftentimes, families will, they'll get stunned when they look at the sticker price of all of this. And they say, no, 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 we can't afford it. But oftentimes, and Mark can attest to this, and Senior Helpers is a great company that will help families do this. It doesn't mean you have to have somebody 24/7. You work it out in the best possible way with the family. So somebody in the family might do Tuesday, somebody might do Thursday, maybe somebody does Sunday, and you fill in with the support. And that's where you start, because it's really, you want to minimize the number of transitions that your loved one is making, and keeping them in a familiar environment among people they're familiar with is really the most beneficial.
Mark, how do you navigate?
Every situation is different, so that's the first thing. So you may talk to your friend or your neighbor, or your husband may have dealt with this with his parents versus what you're going through with yours. And every one of those journeys is very, very different. There's some general things you can learn from it, but don't be afraid to take a clean sheet of paper out and don't worry about what everyone else is told. Stop and do your homework. The first thing we do is try to get a view of it from the top down. How complex is the situation? What are the dynamics? In many cases, we'll bring in an overall attorney or we'll bring in a geriatric case manager because there are things that we can't do. Other times, we can manage the assessment. First thing we're trying to do is understand what are the issues, what are the risks, what are the goals and the objectives. So from a risk perspective, we're looking at are there safety issues? Are there issues of autonomy and independence? Are there issues of quality of life engagement? And we'll go through and do a risk profile. We'll then sit down with the family and try to understand what the objectives are. Do we know what their wishes are? In many cases, especially in this area, we find that people have written down what their objectives are. What are the objectives of the family? What are the resources that are there? Resources doesn't just mean monetary resource. It can be exactly as Carolyn talked about. We said, well, if they need this much care as we look across the 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, here's what the family can do. Here's what some programs out there can cover. What's the gap? What's the best way to manage that gap, and best means quality of care as well as the economics, and there are a lot of choices to make. So once we have that picture, we can then figure out what the right answer is in terms of the scope of care. So in our case, we have a nurse do that, and go through and review and understand and what the right resource looks like. So an aide is not an aide is not an aide. These are amazingly talented individuals. We have aides, for example, who are great in the earlier stages of dementia. We have others who are much better at later stages. So what's the right fit for that individual and what their needs are and what their journey is at the present time? And it may change over time. What we find with families is they usually wait too long to make the decision. So there are certain windows where you can introduce change. And if that change can go well, and there are ways to introduce that change so that change can go well. But if you wait until it's an emergency or it's a crisis, you'll probably get through it, but it won't be a pleasant experience for anyone. Whether it's the five siblings that are not at all happy with what happened because it was made in an emergency, or transitions had to happen faster than planned, or without the economic resources set up the way you wanted to. So start early, do your homework, build a plan, understand it's going to change, you get the right expertise. It's really my advice to the families.
How do you deal with cultural issues in terms of, it's my mom, it's my dad, no one can or should take care of them other than me at home?
How do you tackle that, particularly when you're bringing in stranger into the house?
That's incredibly hard. Often we bring in help, an expert for those things. And a lot of it, it's the way that it's done. It's the kindness with which it's done, the way that it's done with the individual, as well as with their family. For a lot of folks, how many of you are oldest daughters in this room? Care disproportionately falls to you. For a lot of folks, you know, asking for that third-party help, that expertise, for many of the families we deal with, you probably see this, and you probably do too, they feel it's a sign of weakness or failure if they're bringing in help. It's not. It's not. It's overwhelming. There's a higher probability that you will do some sort of harm to yourself, just mentally, fatigued, economically, if you don't get that help. So reach for it early, and make sure that you can deal with those changing dynamics, you know, that you're introducing. The other thing we see is aides come from all walks of life in there, and we see families not really understanding what some of those differences and cultures and so forth are. What you're really looking for is an individual that's compassionate, that is well-trained, and most importantly, well-managed in terms of how that care is delivered. The other aspects, do what I do, go to a professional.
So the cultural question is a great question, because a lot of our caregivers are from different cultures. You're not on the South Shore, you're not going to get an Irish Catholic caregiver. Sorry, that's oftentimes not the case. But there's two things. First of all, not being able to be that daughter or that son to the parent, it is very hard when you're taking on that caretaking role. And that's something that Mark certainly stresses with his caregivers, and I stress it with families too. You know, allow yourself to step back and be the daughter, be the son, or be the spouse, or, you know, in some instances, even be the mother. I mean, whatever role you play, let it be that. If you can bring in help with a caregiver or some other professional support, do it. And as far as caregivers go, the best caregivers that I have ever worked with are from different cultures than my own. And they do have the strength of compassion that we don't often see in our very hurried home culture. And I try to stress the commonalities that they have. You know, some of my clients, they like to call themselves foodies. You know, if they branch out and have, you know, mozzarella on their salad, they're a foodie. So you find those commonalities, and then, you know, soon enough they're cooking together, they're talking about recipes, or they're talking about fashion, and they start developing a relationship that is based on where your loved one is at this time in their life. They don't have any of the past memories, they don't have the past relationship, they don't know what's been lost. So they can, that takes a lot of pressure off your loved one, believe it or not, because they don't have to prove anything. And it's just a nice way to move forward with you being the loved one that you once were and bringing in a different aspect that can be very positive.
And one thing you both touched upon, which I don't think is talked about enough, is when the caregiver is a spouse and the toll that it can take on a spouse caring for someone when that relationship has completely changed, and when you're kind of changing, or not changing roles, but it often helps to step back as the caregiving spouse and let help come in, because otherwise it's taking a toll on your health and as the caregiver, and you see a downside in the caregiver at the same time as you see a downside in the person who needed the care to begin with.
Elizabeth, can you take us through the sort of Cliff Notes version of Medicare, Medicaid, and how it all works? And yeah.
So how much time do I have? The Cliff Notes is, it's a lot easier if you're married than if you're single. That's step one. There's a lot more rules that allow you flexibility if you're a married couple where one person needs the care than if you're a single individual. As a single individual, you can only qualify for Medicaid if you, I'm sorry, I want to take a step back. Medicare, everybody gets. Medicare is for when you're over 65, and everybody automatically gets it. Medicaid is a program that you need to financially qualify for. And you financially qualify for that as a single person by having less than $2,000 in assets. There are different programs that count different things. If you need Medicaid while still living at home and you're looking for that to cover home care, personal care attendants, things like that, then the equity in your house doesn't always count. If you are looking for the Medicaid to pay for long-term care or nursing home care, because there's really only a couple ways to pay for that. You have long-term care insurance, which you bought way before you had this problem. You use your own financial assets and pay privately, or you qualify for Medicaid. And if you're going to be qualifying for Medicaid, then literally every asset that you have as a single person counts towards that $2,000. It's your retirement, cash value of your life insurance, your car, your house, savings accounts that you opened up for kids or grandkids, 529 plans that you opened up for kids or grandkids. Every little penny that you accumulated counts towards that $2,000. As a married couple, that $2,000 threshold is the same for the person who needs the care, but the person who's staying at home, the well spouse, who's still going to be living in the community, can keep $120,000, which, again, doesn't sound like very much money at all, because it isn't, say you now have to live off $120,000 for as long as you're going to live. Doesn't matter if that's 2 or 20 years. But the house does not count, and a car does not count. So you can have a house valued up to, I think it's $860,000 in Massachusetts before the value of that house is going to start to count towards a Medicaid qualification. And without getting into the nitty-gritty confusing details, there are ways that you can use trusts and annuities to help married couples on an emergency basis qualify and kind of move those funds around to show that you have $120,000 or $2,000. Wow. And that was a pie in the sky. So across the board for the panel, top three things that you would recommend a newly diagnosed caregiver does. Mark?
Should do or that be new?
Yes. Both.
First thing we see families do is unfortunately panic, right? And they start to try to make a whole lot of decisions very fast in a crisis. Don't need to make a decision in a crisis, right? It's a long-term progressive disease. First, stop and take a deep breath, right? Figure out what your plan is going to be. Get the information you need. We have folks that they get a diagnosis, all of a sudden they realize they need care, and they start panicking about the overall cost. Well, you may need 24-hour care for a day, 2 days, 3 days, just while you get everything set up and arranged. Then it might go down to 4 hours or 5 hours a day. There's a big difference in that. You don't have to make long-term decisions right out of the gate. So first thing to do is take a deep breath, not panic. The second thing to do is understand what your needs are now and what your needs are likely to do, and then go through the rest of the process. And make sure you choose partners in this, because that's what we all are for our families. We're partners in this journey that they're on, are willing to be flexible and adjust as those needs adjust over time. If not, they're not a good partner, so don't play. Find another one. And there are a lot out there. And for example, we might be a great partner for family A. We may not be as good a partner for family B, and that's perfectly fine. Understand what the qualities of good are. Understand what good is for you, and make the right decisions over the right time period that you need to make. You don't have to panic. We had a family just recently, and they were worried they were going to need to go into a long-term care facility. Sometimes we call them nursing homes. Sometimes they're the long-term side of rehabs, but that's what we're talking about. And they were panicked that they had to choose the one that was being offered right then. And we sat down and we explained to them, you don't have to. We helped take mom home for 2 weeks while they went around and they interviewed the different communities. And they realized what characteristics they wanted, what was important to them. They realized they were going to be paying privately for a short period of time. And that was very important because they were able to choose because they were paying privately for a short period of time. And then as they exhausted their assets, they flowed into a Medicaid environment, but they were already there. So stop and take the time to make the right decisions in the right way with the right information.
Yeah, I agree with Mark that one of the first things, if not always the first thing, is that panic does set in. And again, take that deep breath and reach out. Don't stay in isolation. Unfortunately, there is still stigma with Alzheimer's. I mean, people are very private about it. I've had several clients that have been engineers or have been, high-level professionals, and it's very, the families are embarrassed to talk about this cognitive decline and reach out and get the support that you need. And that could be just, making a phone call to senior helpers or to me or to an attorney like Elizabeth. It doesn't obligate you to anything, but it's a starting point, and it can give you a compass. Where do you go from here? One of the unfortunate things that happens repeatedly for all of us in the industry is that people will reach out because they are in crisis, and they want the help, and they're going to follow up in a day or two. And then they've sort of figured things out. They found a Band-Aid that's working, and so they're good. They don't need any type of support. But 3 to 4 days later, or 3 weeks later, the crisis sets in again. And what we all want to encourage all of you to do is get a plan in place. Avoid the crisis. We can help you navigate things so that you're making choices, so that it's going the way you want it to go. And none of it's going the way you want it to go, because you don't want this to be happening. But you can at least have a roadmap in place so that you know the next steps. I can't impress that enough to people to really, try not to operate crisis to crisis to crisis, but get the plan in place and start by just making that one phone call.
I think the most important thing is to get everyone in the family on the same page, because that's going to help you in the now and in the future. And it doesn't matter if you're, a big Italian 5-kid family, or if there's 2 kids or 1 kid or a spouse and 2 kids. If you have everybody on the same page and working towards the same goal, then you're going to be able to utilize the services of a home care agency or a geriatric care manager, which are usually the ones who can help you develop that roadmap of care. But you need to kind of come together as a cohesive family unit so that you don't end up coming to talk to me and saying, well, this one's to call mom's money to go do X, Y, and Z, and we didn't know anything about it, and they didn't include us in any of the decision-making, and then we're investigating if there was a proper power attorney in place, or if there was any type of elder abuse or something like that, which can all be avoided just by having a sit-down conversation at the beginning as to how your family is going to tackle this crisis together. Because the families that work together, whether there's one point person who's doing a lot of the running around, but still keeping everybody else informed as to what's happening, those families go through this process the best.
We'll take questions in a couple of minutes. I think one of the key things that you all have said is there are choices. I think as a family caregiver, you're just high. that there is a choice is critical. So, Carolyn?
I just wanted to share an experience I had recently that speaks to everything that we've been saying, and that is that there were two sons. One of the sons reached out to me to the beginning of January because him and his brother were helping his elderly parents, their elderly parents, and the father has had some cognitive decline. And the parents live independently. You know, 3 years ago, they were in Africa on a safari, and now, you know, he's starting to have some decline. So it's a big change for them. And I encouraged this son to, you know, I'll come down and meet the parents. No, we'll call you when he's going to be discharged home. So, you know, they call me on Saturday, the Super Bowl weekend, you know, because he's coming home Monday. and I am a total fair weather fan. I only show up for the Super Bowl. So, but anyway, I was able to, and that typically happens. We talk to people over time, and then we get that last minute phone call. And we work that way. So I went down, I met the father, I met the mother, I put a whole plan of care in place, we got home care. Mark helped me out with setting up home care down in the Fall River area. And I stayed with them, took them to doctor's appointments, got the whole view of what's going on. They have a whole binder, a whole roadmap in place in their home. And they did really well. Their dad did really, really well. He was strong. He was definitely had the cognitive decline, but they were managing. And I called to check in, and the wife said to me, she was very sort of stern, and she said, "We don't need your services anymore." And I said, "You know, I think you're right. I think you've done so well over these past 3 weeks, and you're really able to navigate things independently right now. You know how to contact me." And the first thing she said to me was, "I thought you were going to be really mad at me." And I said, "No, I'm here to help you. I'm not here to add stress to your life. You don't have to marry us, okay? You just spend the time with us that you need us. And you have the right to say, 'I'm good, I'm all set. And we'll call you back if we need you.' Or go to another geriatric care manager or another home care agency, whatever's going to work for you. So you need to understand that you have that freedom."
I would say from personal experience, and this is kudos to Mark and his team and his counterparts in New York, we challenged them. And we basically said there was no way you're going to be able to find a female Italian-speaking caregiver. And they did. And my sisters and I were like, "Now what?" So, and now we'll open it up for questions from the audience. Please wait for the microphone. Warren will be running around.
If I may interject just a couple of things, because we've been dealing with this for 5 to 6 years. Two things I found to be extremely helpful in trying to coordinate so to get the time to get away is on the web, a place called Share the Care, which has some wonderful forms and a whole, how to set up a whole caring group to provide support. There's also a wonderful book that can't remember name on the top of my head, but it's about setting up a caring group so with family and friends and professionals so that you've got somebody you can call, or if you've got to have somebody help you prepare food, some friend will deliver food one night, another friend the next day, maybe you can come in and cook, or sit with somebody, or play games with somebody, because one of the problems I have is trying to keep my wife active so that I can get work done around the house and work done to pay the bills. I highly recommend that organization, that type of book, in front of you. The other thing is, if you're looking for financial assistance, there are many communities that have foundations that provide assistance for people with Alzheimer's or cancer in that community, and it's designed just to help people in that community. So look for local foundations, because this provided some help for us to do things around the house, like mow the lawn and stuff that we can't get done right now. So that's what I was going to say.
Thank you. And as I said before, calling us at the Alzheimer's Foundation of America, we can provide you with local resources, because we fully understand that not everyone in this room is from Massachusetts, but we can then direct you to our member orgs such as senior helpers, dementia raw, etc., that can help you. Can we talk about the care team? What's the critical components of putting together a care team? Anybody?
When I put together a care team, I generally have caregivers, and I sometimes families have private caregivers that they use, and I'll work with them if they're in place. I do like to go with an agency just because there's more accountability. I know they vetted the caregivers pretty well, or very well. And then I, because my background is in nursing, I really emphasize the medical component, making sure that we have a strong team of doctors in place. And that may sometimes mean, if the families aren't satisfied with the primary care physician, that might mean changing the primary care physician to somebody who is more open to a team approach and working with all the different medical professionals in that person's life. You know, you've got the cognitive decline, and then you've got all these medical issues, and one doctor is prescribing something while another is prescribing something else, and another is prescribing something altogether different. And they all can interact or counteract with each other. And so I try to build teams of medical professionals who are willing to work together and support. That's my biggest push. And then the outer support services like Adult Day Health or groups that they can attend, you know, support groups and that type of thing, I put those in place generally.
We look at it in a similar way. So there's usually a clinical lead. Dementia Alzheimer's is a clinical diagnosis, but most of the intervention until late in the disease is more behavioral. It's social, it's engagement, as you were talking about. It's being active life-wise. So there's a clinical component. There's a behavioral component. Sometimes that's a geriatric case manager or a social worker or other piece. There's often a hands-on care component. That's the type of piece that we do. And there may be a legal component. Everybody's journey is different, but those are usually the four pieces, and each one at any one point in time is going to be a different level of intensity based on what's going on. And that's where having professionals that have navigated that journey with others and on behalf of others is so important. Because, you know, now after spending almost 10 years in the elder care space, I can say I've worked with, you know, a couple thousand families. Well, it was about 1,000 families before I felt comfortable making any sort of generalization, right? And that's something I can't stress enough. Now, there's one family I have no progress with, and that's my own. And it's staggering. My parents go to my sister for help, who knows nothing about this space. So she calls me. I give her the answer. She calls my parents back. Whatever it takes is the point, right? But make sure you have seasoned professionals to help you, because they'll know when something is a generalizable learning that can apply and where it was case-specific and it has no relevance. It's not the mailman's best friend. We had that situation with the family that for the advice was coming. So it's, you have to really pull your experts together, which is, I think, your point, Joseph, is have somebody on the legal side, have somebody on the clinical side, have somebody on the care side, and have somebody that's adept at managing family dynamics, that social work and counseling and such, because you're going to need all of those ingredients in this recipe. At some point, different weightings at different times, but you're going to need all of them.
Yep. I think you guys both put it very well together. Typically, I'm not the person creating the care team. I'm usually just a cog in the wheel, or someone comes to me because they saw a need for a healthcare proxy or a power of attorney, and they know those are important documents. And then they ask me, oh, what else, what are my next steps? What else am I needing to do? And that's when I can usually bring in groups like senior helpers or geriatric care managers and say, you know, you need a team. You cannot do this by yourself. A lot of people do try to do it by themselves, and they do not do well by themselves. And it's when you have
all of those folks in the wheel moving together is when you make progress and you see the family working together.
Do we have any questions or any other questions?
I have a question for Elizabeth. So my question is, if we're dealing with a family that's having difficulty communicating among each other and it's time to go pay a visit to your office, what are some ways that terminology or just different communication skills can we use to try to get the family on board on the same page?
In our office, we call that the family meeting. And we say, maybe it's time for a family meeting to get everybody in on the same page. And I think usually when you invite all parties to the attorney's office, they can see that they're in front of a professional and they're all being included in the decision-making process. And as long as we talk to kind of get everybody's viewpoint in and then tell them what's feasible and what isn't feasible based on the legal documents you have, the legal documents you can create based on where you are with your progression of cognitive abilities, what the courts will and will not allow, and what your money will and will not allow. That's when we can usually get everybody on the same page. But if there are issues, a together sit down with one of us is usually the best way to tackle that.
Well, yeah, I'm going to propose a dilemma. With a parent that has very advanced case, Alzheimer's, progressive case, that needs care, full care, you have four siblings, and only one is going to be taking care of the parent. How do you get the others to recognize their responsibility to overcome the one dealing with this 52 weeks a year? And trying to avoid burnout.
She's gathering her thoughts. I'm just going ahead. We see this a lot. There are a few things that we've seen families do successfully and some things that they haven't done successfully. The first thing is to have an honest and frank family discussion, because there is, and the data is there of what this represents. Sometimes it can be addressed and sometimes it can't. So what we've seen families do is create a strategy for that respite relief. Now, we have some families, for example, that you can't do this 7 days a week. Right? We do 2 days of care every single week, so that this individual is almost like a job. So they work 5 days and we come in and do relief for 2 days. In there, they take 2 or 3 weeks of vacation. They do a contract with the family, physical, written, legal contract for the care they're providing. In some cases, it works all the way through the estate of how things will be dealt with for a compensation. It varies. There are Medicaid programs that can support that. Other times, it's an agreement among the family members for how those things are done. We have watched families negotiate amongst themselves. I'll do the 5 days. But 2 days a week, mom needs something else, but they're not going to use private care. The biggest mistake we see people do is mom will then go stay with you for those 2 days a week. Well, mom can't handle that transition week over week over week. It doesn't work. It's an unfamiliar surrounding. There's not a short-term memory, so that they can't manage that. So they need to figure out a living arrangement to make things like that work. There's no one right answer. The key is, my experience, honest and frank communication, bring in a professional where necessary to manage that dynamic between the family, and where appropriate, use legal agreements for that care being provided to make sure it's done in the way everybody wants and no one's bearing a burden that's unfairly placed on their shoulders.
And I think, you're not going to have just one conversation with siblings. I mean, it's going to be a continued dynamic conversation. But you raise a very interesting point in that when it is one person caring for that loved one, the risk of your own burnout, as you said, but also health compromise is huge. So it really is essential to break down those barriers. I know I'm a person that
If I'm continuing to do something and I'm asking for help and nobody's hearing me, I can get kind of resentful. And I'm giving off a pretty strong vibe and not letting people in. And if I can step back and say, you know, I'm really hurting here, like I really need your help. Sometimes just voicing that is enough to disarm people and they say, hey, okay, wait a minute, we've got to pay attention. But, you know, everything that Mark has said, I'll echo. And it is, you know, those family conversations are sometimes very challenging to navigate. And if you bring in a professional, meet with a home care company, meet with a geriatric care manager, just have those open, honest conversations. And you oftentimes see change and see people helping out more.
And one thing I'll throw into that is recognize each other's strengths. One person may be very good at the care portion, another may be better with having extra time to run to the grocery store or do transportation to doctor's visits. Another might be better with the finances or with meeting with the attorneys. And if you can kind of split the baby to as far as the job, it takes the burden off of that one person who's doing everything. And now you're just focused on the care because that's what you're good at, or that's what you have the time for or your skills for. And let other people take care of the other pieces.
I think also as a family caregiver, one of the things to keep in mind is just because this is the way it's always been doesn't mean this is how it has to go moving forward. Because this is a brand new chapter for any of you dealing with this for the first time. So in a sense, all the rules go out the window and all the preconceived roles also go out the window. We have time for one more question.
First question. Lauren. Yeah, he's having a hard time getting like home care and things because he's not 65. His great elder service where I live is in Cambridge, but he seems to be having a problem there because of his age. And his services and things is. Is there anything that he can, or that the wife can do for him that they would help a little bit more than, you know, at 65?
Have they met with elder services?
No, she just talked on the telephone and they said that if we can't even give you a ride because you're not 65.
I would call back.
Absolutely.
I definitely would call back and because I know I'm not familiar with the elder care, elder services in the Cambridge area, but on the South Shore, you know, you're entitled to some services. There are minimum services that you can get. And I sometimes, you know, I've met with families who have had the same conversations on the phone, and you got to call back. And you got to confirm and say, I'd like to schedule a visit. And you don't, you know, when can you come? You don't say, can you come? Say, when can you come? You know, and demand those services and then go from there. Because at the very least, what those agencies are set up to do is they're a warehouse of information and pointing you in the right direction.
Thank you very much.
Somerville, Cambridge can be hard to navigate because of the size of that geography relative to the level of resources that they have. There are certain things that they can provide that are need-based financially, and there are things that they can provide that are not needs-based. For example, one of the things you want to start with is recommend they go have that meeting, make sure it's a case manager they're meeting with. All right? And then start there. That person has an obligation, if they're a resident of that city or town, to provide the information that they have available, and then go from there. There may not be that much that they can do because of either their economic means or age or qualifications, but whatever they can do, they'll make available. The other place they can often go to is call the hotline from the AFA and ask. There are a lot of resources for younger individuals that suffer from the disease that they can find out or connect you with. We had a client, this was very early on when we first met with the AFA, in his 30s. And we got a tremendous level of resource to be able to help guide him so they could find the person with the expertise.
I think that's also one of the things that seems to elude a lot of us that this is not just a disease for people that are in their 60s and 70s. You know, as Mark said, we are very close to a couple of families in New York where the husband was diagnosed when he was 32. So it's a disease that affects everyone, basically. Mark, Carolyn, Elizabeth, thank you very, very much. I want to remind everybody that Seeking Hope's table has a table in the back, as does BBB. Thank you for not making me say that. And they will be here for the rest of the day, so please give them a round of applause again. Lunch will be outside. Grab your lunch. It'll be set up in a few more minutes. Grab your lunch. Come back in. We're going to be doing a working lunch. And please visit the exhibit tables that are around the room.
Throughput fault. great job.